Welcome, everybody. My name is Anya Keeler, and I'm from the University of Toronto. I'm the moderator today. We will be doing a GU rapid radiology review. We will start with Dr. Darcy Wolfman talking about renal cases, Dr. Ben Wildman-Trobriner talking about prostate, Dr. AJ Mariano about bladder and gynecology cases, and finally, I'll do a more didactic short talk on ovarian. So with no further ado, let's start with Dr. Darcy Wolfman. Welcome.
Hello, I'm Dr. Wolfman. I am at Johns Hopkins in Washington, D.C., and we are going to be doing a rapid renal cases. I do have one disclosure. I am on the advisory board of a company called POCUS Pro. You can look that up. So our objective here are to review some concepts in renal imaging. You guys can read these. So I basically set this up as cases, and each case has a specific teaching point. So we're going to go through as many of these as we can in 20 minutes. So it is a rapid review. So case one, we have a 45-year-old female and the history was pain. And so we have a single ultrasound image here. So there's a hyperechoic renal mass. So what is the differential diagnosis for this? The differential diagnosis is angiomyolipoma and renal cell carcinoma. So a hyperechoic renal mass on ultrasound is not diagnostic of AML. And if anyone out there is a former resident of mine or has heard me lecture before, they're probably not surprised. This is my first little teaching point because this is a huge pet peeve of mine. So it has been shown that renal cell carcinoma under 3 cm on grayscale ultrasound, 50% of them are hyperechoic. So if you see a hyperechoic renal mass on ultrasound, again, it's not diagnostic of AML, but I encourage you to go back in that patient's file and look and see, did they have a prior CT or MR? Because they might not need another exam to prove it, but you do need to prove that there is macroscopic fat. In this case, it was an AML. As you can see, there's macroscopic fat in that lesion. All right, case two. So we have a 65-year-old female and vague abdominal pain. So we have an enhancing renal mass. And what is the diagnosis here? Now, obviously you could say renal cell carcinoma, but we can do a little better than that actually. So this is clear cell renal cell carcinoma. And why do I say that? So the enhancement is equal or more than the adjacent renal cortex. And that's because clear cell renal cell carcinoma under the microscope has a delicate vascular network. So the arrows here are pointing to all of the little blood vessels on this slide. And you'll just have to take my word for it that this is a lot of vascularity for a low power image. So a delicate vascular network under the microscope translates to hypervascularity at imaging. So when you see an enhancing renal mass and the enhancement is equal or more than the adjacent renal cortex, we're going to think that that's most likely clear cell RCC. Case three. So this is a 56-year-old male on dialysis for 6 years. And so the question here is, what is the patient's risk of RCC? Well, the first thing we notice is that the patient has bilateral atrophic kidneys with multiple bilateral small renal cysts. And what you need to know is that that is diagnostic of acquired cystic disease. So on a patient on dialysis with this appearance of the kidneys, they have acquired cystic disease. And acquired cystic disease confers a 7% increased risk of renal cell carcinoma. And this is really important for us to know as radiologists because acquired cystic disease is a radiologic diagnosis. We're the ones who diagnose this based on the imaging appearance. And these patients then need to be followed because of this increased risk of RCC. So acquired cystic disease, briefly, it develops in patients with end-stage renal disease undergoing dialysis, both peritoneal and hemodialysis, interestingly. And the percentage of patients who develop acquired cystic disease is directly related to the number of years that they have been undergoing dialysis. The imaging is these small bilateral kidneys and multiple bilateral cysts. So they're really small cysts. It's, you know, when you do that MR and there's just these tiny little cysts everywhere, that's what this is. And again, these patients have an increased risk of RCC, so they are going to be imaged and monitored in order to prevent that from becoming a problem. Case four. So we have a 72-year-old male diabetic. They're in the ICU and they have worsening sepsis and they got a CT, and here is the CT. So what is the diagnosis here? Pretty obvious, right? So it's emphysematous pyelonephritis. The key here is that there's air in the renal parenchyma. So air in the collecting system or ureter is not emphysematous pyelonephritis. Air in the renal parenchyma is emphysematous pyelonephritis. And what's the next best step for this? Well, this is a surgical emergency. This cannot wait till morning. Somebody needs to know about this ASAP. And that's because this is a surgical emergency with a 30 to 60% mortality. So basically the renal parenchyma here is necrotic and dying. And if they don't get that kidney out, there's a very high probability that this will kill the patient. Here's the corresponding gross pathology. And you can see the necrosis there corresponding to the air in the renal parenchyma. Case number five. So this is a 28-year-old female with right flank pain. And we can see here there's a cystic lesion in the kidney. So what history do we need to provide a diagnosis? Well, in this case, clinical signs and symptoms is key. So in this patient, she had a recent treatment for pyelonephritis, continued right flank pain, and fever and dysuria. With this imaging appearance and that clinical history, this is a renal abscess. But we have to be really careful here, because if this was a patient who came in for follow-up of a, you know, liver lesion or something, nothing related, no appropriate clinical history for renal abscess, then the Bosniak criteria need to be applied to this because this is a cystic renal mass. So a clinical history is key to diagnosing a renal abscess. Case six. So we have a 56-year-old male with new onset uncontrolled hypertension. So what's the diagnosis? So it's renal artery stenosis, which is pretty straightforward, right? We've got the aorta measurement of 57, proximal renal artery of 299. So the criteria for renal artery stenosis on ultrasound, as a reminder, the renal artery over aorta peak systolic velocity ratio should be over 3.5. And I always look for this tardis parvis waveform distally in the renal artery. So you definitely want the 3.5 ratio, but always look in that distal renal artery to see if they have this tardis parvis waveform. That can help to add to the diagnosis. And then our next question is, what are the two most common causes of ARRS? So atherosclerosis is far and away the most common, and that's going to be at the origin or the proximal renal artery. Second most common is fibromuscular dysplasia, and that stenosis is going to be at the mid or distal renal artery. So that's one of the reasons it's so important that when you're doing ultrasound for renal artery stenosis, that we, yes, look at the origin, because atherosclerosis is the most common, and that's where that stenosis is going to be. But we also need to interrogate both the mid and distal renal artery, because that's where the stenoses and fibromuscular dysplasia are going to be. Case seven. So this was a 26-year-old high-speed motor vehicle collision, and you can see the arterial extravasation on that lower image. So what other images are needed to fully evaluate the kidney injury? So we do have this arterial extravasation, but are we sure there's not another injury? So you have to make sure that there are delayed images to evaluate the collecting system or your renal injury, especially in light of having an renal arterial injury. These patients can have more than one injury to the kidney. And here you can see there was also a collecting system injury on that same side. And those sorts of things can change how they manage these patients. Case eight. So there was a renal mass on outside ultrasound and the patient had a CT, and you can see a representative image here. And the impression on the CT was Bosniak 4 lesion, worrisome for RCC, further evaluation advised. And so the question is that impression appropriate? Is that correct? And no, it is not correct. So the Bosniak criteria should not be used in this case. And we're going to have a couple cases where I review some of the Bosniak. When I put this together, they were very new criteria. Now that it's 2021, they're a little bit further out, but the Bosniak 2019 criteria specify the criteria should only be used if less than 25% of the mass is solid. So in this case that we're looking at, very clearly more than 25% of this lesion is solid. So the Bosniak criteria should not be used in this case. Here's the statement taken directly from the paper. There was also more specific definitions for imaging features in Bosniak 2019 in order to help stratify lesions more appropriately. Separate CT and MR criteria were also developed. And here's a chart that I actually put into a Word document and kind of use whenever I have a cystic renal mass to help me classify these lesions. Case 9. This is an 18-year-old male with left-sided pain. And you can see that they have a central renal mass. So what is the differential diagnosis here? So you can see that mass. And this would be my general differential diagnosis. I'd say RCC, Wilms tumor, renal medullary carcinoma, possibly a lipid-poor AML, or a Ewan sarcoma or PNET tumor. But what clinical information in the chart could really help narrow the differential? Because remember, this is an 18-year-old kid with left-sided pain. So in this case, the presence of sickle cell disease or trait, unfortunately, really narrows this down to renal medullary carcinoma. Renal medullary carcinoma is very strongly related to sickle cell trait, and especially in young patients. So you tend to see this in very young patients who have sickle cell disease or trait. And it's important to recognize this and look for it in the chart because unfortunately, renal medullary carcinoma has a very poor prognosis. So the sooner this patient can start on treatment, the better. Case 10. So this is a 62-year-old male with an incidental renal lesion. And the question is, does this lesion require follow-up? So we have an axial T1 fat sat pre. So we have a homogeneous high T1 lesion that is 3 centimeters. So no, based on the new Bosniak MR criteria, this would be a Bosniak 2 lesion. So no follow-up would be required. So this is a homogeneous mass that's markedly hyperintense at T1 non-contrast MR. So these are some of the changes from the old criteria for high T1 fat sat renal lesions. Size is no longer relevant. And the lesions, they used to distinguish homogeneous from heterogeneous, and they tease that out a little bit more. So if you have a homogeneous mass that's high T1 signal, no follow-up is required. Here is that broken down. Again, you can, I urge you, if you haven't already, to look this up and start using these criteria. They can be very helpful for not having to follow masses that we know are not going to turn into a malignant neoplasm. Case 11. So this is a 59-year-old female with right upper quadrant pain. And so we have an axial T1 fat sat post. We have two phases here. We have a corticomedullary and a little nephrogenic phase. So we have an enhancing renal mass. And the enhancement is equal or more than the adjacent renal cortex. And like we talked about earlier, the diagnosis here is most likely clear cell renal cell carcinoma. Now I show this case because there is a beautiful central scar on this image, but I want to point out, and the reason I show this case is that a central scar is not specific for oncocytoma. So just because there's a central scar here, we should not be saying that this is an oncocytoma. And the other thing that I always like to point out is oncocytoma is actually extraordinarily rare. It's a very, very rare tumor. So if they treat this like a clear cell renal cell carcinoma and it happens to be an oncocytoma, then great for the patient. But the truth is it's far more likely to be a clear cell RCC than it is to be an oncocytoma, even with a central scar. Case 12. So this is a 53-year-old who has staging CT for chromophobe RCC. So what findings are going to change management? So, you know, we can say there's a mass here, but what more does the urologist want to know? So here's the list of things. They want to know the size of the mass in greatest dimension, regional lymph nodes, extension into the renal vein or IVC, extension beyond the kidney, and then extension beyond gyrotis fascia. And the reason these things are so important is because these change potential management and potential options for treatment. Some of these make it so that the patient is no longer eligible for, say, partial nephrectomy or watchful waiting, active surveillance, or even resection. If it's extension beyond gyrotis fascia, even radical nephrectomy can be difficult. So it is important to include all the pertinent positives and negatives in the report, not just no metastatic disease. I actually do, especially in the impression, will put, you know, no regional lymph nodes, no extension to the renal vein or IVC, no extension beyond the kidney, or no extension beyond gyrotis fascia, just to really lay it out for the urologist and give them all of the important information that they need. Case 13. So this is a 64-year-old for staging for clear cell renal cell carcinoma. And when you look at this, this looks like something that might be eligible for partial nephrectomy. But normally I'd have an audience and I'd kind of be able to judge if anyone knows or if people are using the criteria used by urologists to determine if partial nephrectomy can be done. And they use something called the nephrotomy score. And we're just going to go through this briefly. And I actually have a PowerScribe macro that I will put in the impression and put these things for the urologist. They can look at it and do it themselves, which they often do. But most of the urologists I work with are very happy that this information is just there for them to use. So the largest diameter in any single plane is the first thing. Then they look at, is it exophytic or endophytic? So the percentage of the mass that is exophytic relative to the renal parenchyma. Then they look at nearness to the collecting system. So you're going to measure the shortest distance between the mass and the collecting system. Then you're going to look at, is an anterior or posterior? So based on the coronal planes at the level of the hilar vessels, is this lesion anterior, posterior, or neither? Does it cross through? This is the one that I didn't understand the most when I first started doing this, and that's the location relative to the polar line. So you can see this diagram down here at the bottom. So entirely above or below those polar lines, so the dark lines there are the polar lines. That lesion there is one that crosses a polar line. That one labeled A there is one that 50% across the polar line. So you can see that it crosses the polar line, but more than 50% is in that middle portion. Crosses the axial renal midline. So you can see that large mass there, and it actually not only crosses polar lines, it crosses the midline. Or you can have a mass that is entirely between polar lines, that's labeled C. And then finally, the last thing is it a hilar tumor touching a renal artery or vein? So basically, they get a score for all of these things. It comes up as a score, and this determines whether the lesion is going to be eligible for partial nephrectomy or not. So this is the criteria that urologists are using. So to be helpful to our clinical colleagues, this is important information for them to have. And in reality, when you're reading these cases, it really doesn't take very long to just, especially if you have a macro, just kind of click on these things, put them in, and then the information is there for the urologist. Case 14. So this is a 72-year-old male with hematuria. So what's the differential diagnosis here? Well, what are we looking at? We have cheliactasis without pelviactasis. So the asterisk here is on cheliactasis. But you'll notice that there's no pelvic ectasis. There's actually material within that renal collecting system. So if you have calecystitis without pelvic ectasis, we're really thinking two things. Urothelial carcinoma or hemorrhage can occasionally do this. But in a 72-year-old male with hematuria, you're really concerned that there's a urothelial carcinoma in there. And here's the corresponding gross pathology. This was a urothelial carcinoma. You can see that calecystitis and the tumor within the pelvis. And this is the last case. So we have a 45-year-old male with vague left flank pain. We have a CT here. So again, we have an enhancing renal mass. But what's the diagnosis here? So this is a chromophobe or papillary RCC, not a clear cell. And why is that? Well, notice that the enhancement here is less than the adjacent renal cortex. And that's because chromophobe and papillary RCC both have much less vascularity than clear cell RCC. They actually have very little vascularity. You can see on this image here, the arrows are pointing to the blood vessels. So lack of vascularity under the microscope means hypovascular at imaging. So that's why chromophobe and papillary RCC have enhancement less than the adjacent renal cortex. It's that lack of vascularity that they see under the microscope. Thank you very much for your attention.